that the vulgar, the cheap, and the tawdry is out. There is no room on the screen at any time for pictures which offend against common decency, and these the industry will not allow.
This video essay is on queerness in film during the 20th century and the impact it had on queer film today. For the bulk of this essay, I'll be talking about the implications of the Hays Code and into the MPAA rating system and looking at the queer coding that had to take place in order for any queer representation at all. Before looking into the Hays Code, it is important to note that in 1915, there was a Supreme Court case titled Mutual Film Corporation versus Industrial Commission of Ohio. This case ruled by a 9-0 vote that free speech protection did not extend to motion pictures. So once the Hays Code was able to limit the content in films, the law would also back up their censorship. In 1930, the Association of Motion Picture Producers and Distributors of America released a document titled The Motion Picture Production Code, which was later known as the Hays Code after Will Hays, the MPPDA president. This code highlighted strict guidelines all filmmakers had to follow in order for their film to be released for public viewing. The code was implemented 6 months after the stock market crash of 1929 because Hollywood wanted to assure New York and the rest of the country that they were going to make a change for the better, both morally and financially. The Hays Code explicitly states that in the case of impure love, the love which society has always regarded as wrong and which has been banned by divine law, the following are important. First, impure love must not be presented as attractive and beautiful. Second, it must not be the subject of comedy or farce or treated as material for laughter. Third, it must not be presented in such a way as to arouse passion or morbid curiosity on part of the audience. Fourth, it must not be made to seem right and permissible. Fifth, in general, it must not be detailed in method and manner. These rules would prohibit all mentions of homosexuality in film. The code states that motion pictures, quote, may be directly responsible for spiritual or moral progress, for higher types of social life, and for much correct thinking, end quote. The transition from silent to talking pictures made the code creators realize that it was necessary to govern the production of talking pictures because they have way more of an impact over silent pictures that were previously being made. After the implementation of the code, each production manager would have to submit in confidence a copy of each or any script to the Association of Motion Pictures Producers Incorporated. Those who are looking over these scripts are able to change almost everything about the film, so that it would then follow the Motion Picture Production Code. In 1934, Joseph Breen was then appointed as the new leader of the Production Code Administration. His goal was to banish, in thought, word, and deed, any and all immoral material from the world of film. He stated that he thought it was his, quote, sacred duty to protect the spiritual well-being of the innocent souls who fluttered too close to the unholy attractiveness of the motion picture screen, end quote. He had the power to change words, personalities, and plots of a script in order to make a film follow the strict guidelines of the code. One director, Mae West, stated that she would write extremely explicit scenes that she didn't want in the screenplay originally in order to distract Breen so that he would put everything that she did want into her screenplay. The MPPDA understood that film, quote, occupies the minds and affections during leisure hours and ultimately touches the whole of their lives, end quote. They believed that implementing this code would recreate and rebuild human beings exhausted with the realities of life. Movies can have a huge effect on people. With the code implemented, movies did not show real life. Beds had to be perfectly made. Husband and wife couldn't sleep in the same bed or hint towards sexual relations. Crimes permitted in films had to follow extremely strict guidelines, while also dancing and costumes were limited to what can or cannot be shown on screen. These rules weren't always followed in every movie, which you can see if you look back at films from the 1940s and the 1950s, but it was a guarantee that any display or mention of homosexuality wouldn't be explicitly shown in films. That didn't stop Hollywood from adding in subtext through their films. Many films were banned from movie theaters because of their mention of homosexuality, and some films had very obvious subtext of queerness that seemed to slip through the cracks. Censorship allowed for the film's viewers to interpret between text and subtext to find the true story, and this is mostly what I'll be basing most of my essay on, is finding that subtext and bringing to light the queer representation that was on films during this time. Many times, the way that a film would pass the code and be shown in theaters with mentions of homosexuality was because the queer person would be a villain or die at the end of the story. If the queer person seemed to, quote, pay for his crime, end quote, then it would be approved by the Hays Code. The code was trying to push this agenda that being queer was a crime and deserved punishment. Many films from 1930 to 1950 demonstrate this constant trope of queer death at the end of the story. The Wizard of Oz, created in 1939, is one of the most popular films in connection to queer cinema due to the phrase, "a friend of Dorothy's," which was used as a code to indicate someone's sexual identity as gay. This film can be interpreted for queer representation for a lot of reasons that might go unnoticed to the straight viewer.
Alexander Doty, who wrote a book called Flaming Classics, Queering the Film Canon, wrote about his first experience watching the movie as a boy as he struggled with his own gay sexual identity. He stated how the Cowardly Lion taught him self-hatred and sang about how miserable he was to be a sissy. Doty explained that he felt he was that sissy and felt embarrassed to see that side of him on screen.
Yeah, it's sad, believe me, missy, when you're born to be a sissy without the feminine vibe. But I could show my prowess, be a lion, not a mouse, if I only had the nerve. I'm afraid there's no denying, I'm just a dandelion.
The Cowardly Lion demonstrates the classic gay stereotypes of being flamboyant and effeminate. It wasn't until later in his life, when he found out about the word camp, that his view on the Cowardly Lion changed. He stated that camp finally let him make his peace with the Cowardly Lion. He was still over the top, but no longer an embarrassment. The Cowardly Lion is also shown in the film with nearly identical perms and hair bows to Dorothy to reveal an ultra-sissified lion. Doty explained that the Wizard of Oz helped him to battle with some of the remaining limitations and perversions of his straight upbringing. For many people, The Wizard of Oz is a sacred text from their childhood, and therefore should not be connected to sexuality or queerness at all. But the queer community is not trying to take the film away from the straight community. Instead, they are looking for representation at a time when there wasn't.
Rope, directed by Alfred Hitchcock in 1948, centers around two men that place the body of the young man they have murdered in a chest that they will use for the perverse dinner party they will host, one that includes the murdered man's aged father as a guest. The two men, Brandon and Philip, were gay men who lived together in the apartment where the dinner party takes place. The whole movie centers around the one dinner party and the guests in attendance. The film reinforces harmful, derogatory myths of homosexuality, which were that queer people were villains and psychopaths.
Brandon, how did you feel?
When?
During it?
I don't know, really. I don't remember feeling very much of anything. Until his body went limp, and I knew it was over.
And then?
Then I felt tremendously exhilarated. How did you feel?
Brandon is seen to be superior to his counterpart, Philip, and displays that he needs to be the most intelligent person at the party. He seems to put on a persona at the party that nothing affects him, including the murder he had just committed. Hitchcock made a film about two gay men and never shows them kissing. The question is, while watching this movie, is do they kiss off screen? It is quite clear that they are gay, they live together, but are they technically lovers? The Hays Code would not allow these questions to be answered during the film. In 1948, the code would not allow for Brandon and Philip to kiss, or even be told that they ever do so. But the film could show them share the intimate experience of jointly strangling another young man. The film shows how much Brandon and Philip hate each other, but never how much they could love each other, because displaying homosexual love would be against censorship and society.
I don't know what you thought or what you are, but I know what you've done. You've murdered! You've strangled the life out of a fellow human being who could live and love as you never could. And never will again.
What are you doing?
It's not what I'm going to do, Brandon. It's what society's going to do. I don't know what that'll be, but I can guess. And I can help. You're going to die, Brandon, both of you. You're going to die.
This video focuses mostly on Hollywood and United States cinema, but to show how the Hays Code implemented banning films, I'm going to talk about a silent French film, Un Chant d'Amour. From 1950, with a running time of only 28 minutes, this short black and white film, directed and released by Jean Genet, survives in poor, scrappy copies as it was not given a commercial release. In many places, this film was confiscated, banned, or simply not shown on grounds of taste or the homosexuality displayed in it. Un Chant d'Amour has two different elements that would allow for it to be banned in the 1950s. The film's display of explicit violence and sex, or the display of homosexual love without sex included. In the category of explicit violence and sex, the film shows men masturbating in grotty prison cells, scenes of whipping and of a gun being forced down a man's throat, penises, armpits, toenails, and other body parts in close-up. The film also displays gay love with scenes of two men frolicking in a forest landscape. Jean Genet uses four types of sequences throughout the film. First, inside the prison cell, where two men are communicating through a wall. This sequence is focused heavily throughout the film, and mostly what you take away from it. Second, shots of garland flowers being swung from a cell window and eventually caught by a hand coming from the next cell window. Men making love in careful poses with idealizing lighting so their genitals are shielded from view. Fourth, sequences of two of the men from the prison in the woods chasing and playing with each other before beginning to make love. Each of these different shots come together to tell two stories, the guard and the prisoners as they discover their own sexuality. This film demonstrates how Hollywood had it all wrong. The Hays Code stopped Hollywood from creating beautiful original stories that don't convey the gay prisoners as bad psychotic villains, but can be displayed as men with true love and emotions towards one another. In terms of trans representation in film during the 1950s, I'm going to talk about Ed Woods, Glenn or Glenda from 1953. Ed Woods is a crossdresser himself. Woods wrote, directed, and stars in this film. This movie capitalizes on the story of Christine Jorgensen, who was on every headline during this time. Christine Jorgensen was a trans woman who had just undergone sex reassignment surgery. This film tells two stories, one a crossdresser played by Ed Woods himself, and one a trans woman named Anne, based on Christine Jorgensen. Glenn wants to marry his girlfriend Barbara, but he is nervous to reveal the secret of his crossdressing. There is a scene in the film which highlights how on Halloween, Glenn was able to be Glenda without ridicule or fear.
You want to borrow your sister's dress? What for?
I want to wear it to the Halloween party.
There are names for boys who go around wearing girls' clothes.
Glenn did wear the dress to the Halloween party. He even took first prize. Then, one day, it wasn't Halloween any longer.
A trans woman named Sylvia stated that before her transition, Halloween was a time when she could dress however she wanted without fear of being assaulted or attacked, and how this line was so relatable to her, and how she was able to see herself on screen. Edward stated that the film was a topic of discussion with the censors many times, but as long as the quote, wrongdoer, the deviant doer, the evil doer, is put down at the end, the films generally pass the censor, end quote. To be able to release the film, Woods had to end the film by using pseudoscience to, quote, cure Glenn of his want to crossdress. There is a scene from the film that allows for a happy moment of trans representation. The scene of Glenn telling Barbara about Glenda.
Tell her of the nighties and negligees, the sweaters and skirts, the robes and dresses, the stockings and the high-heeled shoes, the wig and the makeup. All that goes to make Glenn into Glenda. He tells Barbara he cannot cheat her of the knowledge that she, as his fiancée, should possess. All the facts. He tells her softly, hurriedly at first, then slowly as he becomes more technical. His hands move to caress the smooth material of her Angora sweater, which he has so long and so desperately wanted to put on his own body. He tells of this to her, and she looks to the sweater and to his hand. Then, when it is all over and that much of the story he knows is told, Barbara is not sure of her own thoughts.
That's about it, darling. I wanted to tell you for a long, long time, but just couldn't bring myself to do it. I've been too much afraid of losing you.
Understand this, but maybe together we can work it out.
Barbara giving Glenn her sweater shows her acceptance of Glenda. The second story follows Anne, a trans woman and a GI, which follows the story of the real Christine Jorgensen. The terminology used in this film is incorrect, as they put crossdresser and transgender people into the same term of transvestite. This term is outdated, and crossdressers and trans people are different and should not be lumped together. Anne's doctor uses her dead name in the film, Always First, and does not use her correct pronouns until after her surgery. This conveys that trans people need to have a medical procedure to be seen as their gender, which is not true. Wood's story of Anne ends with her being happy that she has become a, quote, full woman. But it paints the light that the surgeon and psychologist have all of the power in who gets a transition and who doesn't. This film is quite avant-garde, but it conveys a quite complex story of gender fluidity. This film has many problems that are seen as problematic today, but this is a better depiction than seen in other films, as trans people are the butt of the joke.
We're dressed as ballerinas. Of course you know we're not.
Or the psychopathic killer. Suddenly Last Summer, directed by Joseph L. Mankiewicz in 1959, describes another side of homosexuality in film from the time of the Hays Code. It describes the trope that the queer person dies at the end of the story. This film takes place in 1937 as Dr. John Kurowitz, a young neurosurgeon, has been summoned by the wealthy matriarch named Violet Venable, played by Katharine Hepburn. Violet has offered a large sum of money to fund the doctor's research at the State Mental Hospital, in return that he performs a lobotomy on Violet's niece, Katharine, played by Elizabeth Taylor. Violet's son, Sebastian, has died while on vacation under mysterious circumstances the previous summer. Katharine was with Sebastian on this trip and during his death, but can't remember the details of what had happened the previous summer. Violet and Sebastian had an extremely close mother and son relationship, which is a classic stereotype of gay men from films during the 1940s and 50s. Violet and her son used to attend trips together each year, but Violet suffered a stroke and was no longer useful on their annual vacation. Katharine reveals that the women he would bring on his trip were used as bait to attract young men in Europe.
We were decoys.
Decoys?
For Sebastian, he used us as bait. And when she was no longer able to lure the better fish into the net, he let her go.
Bait for what? What were the better fish?
We procured for him.
This film does not explicitly state this, but it translates that Katharine and Violet's sexual appeal was used to draw men in for Sebastian to have sex with. Katharine takes a truth serum at the end of the movie to try to remember Sebastian's death on the beach. She reveals at the end through a flashback that he was killed and devoured by the same starving boys whom he had himself exploited earlier. The truth of this makes Violet extremely upset because she did not want her son's secret exposed. This film purposefully never shows Sebastian's face, as to allow for the viewer to feel no sympathy for this gay man who had met his untimely death. There are many scenes that can be used to describe the film's internal battle between heterosexuality and homosexuality. There's a scene where Sebastian makes Katharine wear a white bathing suit that turns transparent in the water so that men are drawn towards her, and Sebastian can then go to those boys. The scene describes how in the place of showing gay pornographic images of Sebastian with other men, it shows Elizabeth Taylor sitting on a beach in a bathing suit that she has deemed as transparent.
And there that disturbed you?
Yes.
What?
He bought me a bathing suit I didn't want to wear. I laughed. I said, I can't wear that. Why? It's a scandal to the Jaybirds.
What do you mean? Was this suit immodest?
It was a one-piece bathing suit made of white something. But the water made it transparent. I told him I didn't want to swim in it, but he just grabbed my hand and dragged me into the water all the way in, and I came out looking naked.
Why did he do that? Do you know why he did that?
Yes. To attract attention.
Why? Because he thought you were lonely? Did he think he could shock you out of your depression?
You know why I was doing it. I told you. I was procuring for him. Sebastian was lonely, Doctor. That empty Blue Jay notebook got bigger and bigger. So big it was big and empty, like that big, empty blue sea and sky.
This film perpetuates the notion that being gay was evil and had to be punished. I believe that that's why the Motion Picture Production Code did not flag this film as an interference to sex perversion, because it showcased the ending that they would have wanted.
It looked as if they had devoured him! As if they'd torn or cut parts of him away with their hands, or with knives, or those jagged tin cans they made music with.
In 1952, the Supreme Court case Joseph Bernstein Incorporated versus Wilson allowed for motion pictures to be protected by the First Amendment. This case would then overrule the 1915 Mutual Film Corporation versus the Industrial Commission of Ohio Supreme Court case mentioned earlier in this video. This case, along with Hollywood filmmakers giving up following the code, made the Hays Code start to lose its power. The code officially ended in 1968. After Joseph Breen retired and won an Oscar, as seen in this clip,
for his conscientious, open-minded, and dignified management of a difficult office, the Academy's board has voted an honorary award to the administrator of the code, Mr. Joseph Breen.
Jack Valenti, a former White House advisor, took over the MPAA.
He believed that the code was no longer working and implemented the MPAA rating system, which was a more flexible framework to the code.
We're all familiar with them. There are shortcuts to vital information. That's why, to familiarize you with the movie rating symbols which will be used by this theater, we present the following guide for parents and young people. It is designed to inform parents about the suitability of movie content for viewing by their children. G, all ages admitted, general audiences. GP, all ages admitted, parental guidance suggested. R, restricted, under 17 requires accompanying parent or adult guardian. X, no one under 18 admitted.
The new rating system was designed to guide, not shelter, future generations of moviegoers. With the Hays Code finally free from Hollywood, there comes a new age of film. Without the strict censorship laws, queer films began to be made and distributed throughout the United States. The Boys in the Band, directed by William Friedkin in 1970, displays this new era of film. This film offers a glimpse into a time when being gay and lesbian meant fear of outing in the public sphere. At this time, closeting was necessary for survival. The film centers around a birthday party, which would have been a safe space for gay men depicted in this movie to vent, commiserate, share, bond, and be fully themselves without any fear.
Are you calling me a screaming queen or a tired fairy?
I beg your pardon. There'll be six tired screaming fairy queens and one anxious queer.
One of the characters, Emery, flaunts his flamboyancy proudly and unashamed.
Okay.
Anything for a sis, Mary.
While the others display a more heterosexual persona for self-preservation, which they can finally drop at the party. The characters in attendance are Michael, the host of the party, an alcoholic on the mend, Michael's lover Donald, the math teacher Hank, and his roommate Larry, who are two lovers working out their relationship.
Hank and Larry are lovers. Not just roommates. Bedmates. Lovers.
Michael.
No man has a roommate after he's 30 years old. If they're not lovers, they're sisters.
Hank's the one who's over 30.
You're pushing it.
The effeminate Emery, his friend Bernard, Harold, the birthday boy, Emery's birthday present to Harold, the prostitute cowboy. An unexpected visitor enters the party. Michael's friend from college, Alan, who is straight and whose marriage is on the rocks. Drama ensues as a drunken Michael decides to play a game where each person has to call the one person with whom each player once deeply and secretly loved. There are many important scenes that stuck out to me while watching this film.
Oh, come on, man. You know me. You know how I feel. Your private life is your own affair.
No, I don't know that about you.
Well, I couldn't care less about what people do as long as they don't do it in public or try to force their ways on the whole damned world.
This scene predicted what many homophobic people would say when talking about homosexuality, the idea that what goes on in private is none of their business. Another scene that perfectly defines the end of the Hays Code and into a new era of queer film is the statement about the death of queer people in the end of most films at this time.
It's not always like it happens in plays. Not all faggots bump themselves off at the end of the story.
This film allows for a new perspective in Hollywood, telling the stories of gay men in America. They told stories of what it was like to come to terms with their own sexuality.
I know damn well I did not come out until after I graduated.
What about all those weekends up from school?
Well, I still wasn't out. I was still in the Christ was I drunk last night syndrome.
Oh, man, was I drunk last night. Christ, I don't remember a thing.
You were just guilty because you were Catholic, that's all.
Now, that's not true. The Christ was I drunk last night syndrome knows no religion. It has to do with immaturity. Although I will admit there's a high percentage of it among Mormons.
Trollop.
Somehow we all managed to justify our actions in those days. While later, I found out that Justin Stewart, my closest friend,
other than Alan McCarthy,
was doing the same thing, only he was going up to Boston for weekends. You see, in the Christ was I drunk last night syndrome, you really are drunk. That much of it's true. It's just that you do remember everything.
A lot of guys have to get loaded before they can have sex. Oh, so I've been told.
Donald, if you recall, the first time we made it, I was so drunk, I could hardly stand up.
You were so drunk, you could hardly get it up.
Christ, I was so drunk, I don't remember a thing.
Oh, bullshit, you remember.
Just friends, lovers, no more.
You might as well be. Everyone thinks you are anyway.
Yeah, well, we never were, really.
No, we didn't have time to be. We got to know each other too fast.
This is a film about gay characters played by gay actors, which is unusual even today. Boys in the Band is a turning point, an historical landmark when studying the evolution of queer film.
If we could just learn not to hate ourselves quite so very much.
I know.
To bring the evolution of censorship and queer representation in film full circle, I have to talk about the MPAA rating system today and the problems that it causes for filmmakers trying to release queer stories. Today, the rating system includes G for general audience, PG for parental guidance, PG-13, which restricts those under 13 without parental supervision, R for anyone under 17 requires parental supervision, and NC-17, which prohibits anyone under 17 to be admitted. For a film to be distributed in theaters and acquire marketing, it cannot get above an NC-17 rating. The MPAA raters are parents, who Jack Valenti calls the, quote, average American parent. These people allow for what movies the public is able to see. The real question is, who is the average American parent? These raters will most likely not allow for queer films to receive the same ratings as those featuring heterosexual couples and themes. Films rated PG or PG-13 earned, on average, 76% more revenue than an R-rated movie, which means that these movies featuring queer characters end up losing money, as well as movies losing any chance of being seen due to being slapped by an NC-17 rating, which is undeserved because these movies have identical scenes in R-rated heterosexual films. In 2016, a study took place at the University of Southern California, which found that among 109 films released by the major Hollywood studios and their art film divisions in 2014, and among 305 scripted television and internet series, just 2% of speaking characters were queer, and just 0.6% were transgender. There's a real problem in Hollywood regarding queer representation still today in 2022. It seems that you have to look for queer representation, and there isn't a long list to look at.
Well, girls, I guess it's our turn.
I wouldn't change anything.